not alone in hatred's wake. Show us how to love, show us how to love, show us how.
Halito, my name is Jessica Hopkins. I am the current president of LUNA and a proud member of the Choctaw Tribe of Oklahoma. This morning, I will be reading the land acknowledgement, which Lawrence reads at every function. Lawrence University's Appleton and Door County campuses are located on the ancestral homelands of the Menominee Nation. Currently, there are 11 federally recognized Native American sovereign nations in Wisconsin. We acknowledge these indigenous communities, as well as those who are not federally recognized, who have stewarded this land throughout the generations and pay respects to their elders, past, present, and future. Thank you.
Hello, and welcome to the Lawrence Chapel for this year's Matriculation Convocation. My name is Allison Fleshman, and I am, as the chair of the Public Events Committee, I am thrilled to announce this year's convocation series. On January 28th, we will welcome Kiesi Lehman, the Hubert H. McAlexander Professor of English and Creative Writing at the University of Mississippi. His book, Heavy, An American Memoir, won the Andrew Carnegie Medal for Nonfiction and was named Best Book of 2018 by the New York Times, Publishers Weekly, NPR, the list goes on. I assure you there are a lot of awards. To fully engage with Kiesi's convocation, we will be organizing a community book read in which students, faculty, and staff can participate in a one-day discussion to dive deep into this compelling work. To lure you in, I'd like to briefly read from the front cover of Heavy. In this powerful and provocative memoir, Kiese Lehman fearlessly explores what the weight of a lifetime of secrets, lies, and deception does to a Black body, a Black family, and a nation teetering on the brink of moral collapse. Lehman invites us to consider the consequences of living in a country wholly obsessed with progress, yet wholly disinterested in the messy work of reckoning with where we've been. In Heavy, Lehman writes eloquently and honestly about growing up a hard-headed Black son to a complicated and brilliant Black mother in Jackson, Mississippi. From his early experiences of sexual violence to his suspension from college to his trek to New York as a young college professor, Lehman charts his complex relationship with his family, weight, sex, gambling, and writing. By attempting to name secrets and lies he and his mother spent a lifetime avoiding, Lehman asks himself, his mother, his nation, and us to confront the terrifying possibility that a few of us know how to responsibly love. A personal narrative that illuminates national failures, Heavy is defiant yet vulnerable, an insightful, often comical exploration that begins with a confusing childhood and continues through 25 years of haunting implosions and long reverberations. I encourage you to participate in this community read. More information on this community book read will be provided later in fall term. For our honors convocation on May 27th, when we honor our students' achievements, our colleague, Dr. Megan Pickett, Associate Professor of Physics, will advocate for the stars, whose light is fading due to ever-increasing light pollution in our cities. In her convocation entitled The Stars, Mansions Made by Nature's Hand, Dr. Pickett will explore the ramifications of losing the stars and how we must act to preserve the wondrous night sky. So our convocation series begins today with the Matriculation Convocation, which you are currently watching from a screen. Screens. One thing I have enjoyed from teaching through a screen is getting to know my students and colleagues a little bit more by seeing into their homes and noting what's hanging on the wall or sitting on a shelf. Since Mark's address will focus on home, belonging, and identity, and much of the community will hear from Mark directly from his office via Zoom over the next year, I thought a fun and different approach to introducing Mark would be to take a field trip to his office so we can get a closer look at what's hanging on his wall. Since, hey, this is pre-recorded, and odds are he's not there right now. And welcome to Mark's office. So this is typically the scene that you would see if you have a Zoom meeting with Mark. It's kind of fun. I'm sitting in his chair. It's like I might get in trouble or something. No, I met with Mark last week and he gave me a tour of his office. And the cool thing is that he shared many personal items that just really spoke to him and give him a sense of belonging and a sense of home here on campus. And so one of them is the painting behind me. So this is by Miriam Bierman. And so she is actually the mother of a close friend of his. He's known the family for many, many years. And this is an original artwork from her. And then actually a few years ago, her work was displayed in the Ristin Art Gallery. So fantastic artist. The other thing that Mark shared, and this actually goes along with the fact that we all learned a few weeks ago that this will be Mark's final year at Lawrence. And in his time here, he has built so much with the Full Speed to Full Need campaign, as well as the Be the Light campaign and many other projects. Mark has dedicated himself to expanding our campus. And the cool thing about when he showed me many of the things in his office was when he talked about a few particular pieces, his voice changed a bit, and you could tell that he's truly dedicated to building a richer and stronger campus, whichever campus he finds himself on. And so this piece, actually, that is really heavy, I can scoot it across, hopefully not scratch the desk. Sorry, Mark. So this piece is a gift to him from his colleagues at Princeton, where he built many, many new buildings and oversaw many, many projects. And so, as a gift, they gave him a piece of each building project that he was on, and they even gave him a label or a legend. And so this block, which really spoke to me, is the MM labeled block. There you go. This is the New Frick Chemistry Laboratory Plaza.
That's awesome. Thank you for building a chemistry laboratory plaza, Mark, as well as all of these others. And you can see there are a lot of cubes. So Mark has been spending his life, dedicating his life to really helping campuses expand and to grow. And we are so fortunate to have had you here for the past 7 years. So the other thing that I'd like to show off in his office, everyone has that coffee mug. And so when you're in a meeting and you're grabbing a drink of coffee, it's just good to have a close-up look. Anyway, so when you see Mark enjoying his coffee, raise a toast to Dr. Fauci. Awesome. Well, I'm hopeful that this insight into Mark's office can kind of give you a sense of how much home means, as well as the sense of belonging that one has to what you do. Oh, one more thing, really cool. For all you students out there, Mark has your picture by his computer. So if you email him, he quickly, or if you contact him in any way, there are so many of you. So he makes sure that he will find your face so he can know who you are, because he cares about your success here. I was really moved by that. I thought that was great. Okay, now I'm done. That's all I got. Thank you, Mark, for a wonderful 7 years. You got one more year to go. And I will leave it to you now, back in the chapel, for your convocation on belonging during a pandemic.
Allison, thank you for that unusual and warm introduction and for your leadership of the Public Events Committee this year. I look forward to seeing how you and the committee reinvent our community gatherings. Thank you, Professors Gomez, Ozabrowski, Seek, Spears, and Swan, for that beautiful prelude. You made an excellent selection this year with Show Us How to Love by Mark Miller. No year calls more strongly for love than this one. Thank you, Jessica Hopkins, Class of 22, for reading our land acknowledgement this morning. And thank you, Linda Morgan Clement, the Julie Esch Hervis Dean of Spiritual and Religious Life, for providing closing words for today's convocation. Our postlude today will also be a treat, a piece played by Hung Phi Nguyen, Class of 21. I also want to thank the many members of the Lawrence community who helped me with research for this talk. Each year, Matriculation Convocation has provided an opportunity for me to consider a topic with colleagues across the campus. This year, as in years past, I leave the conversation impressed by the breadth, depth, and generosity of our intellectual campus discourse. Welcome to the academic year. I want to specifically welcome our new first year, transfer, visiting students, and many faculty and staff who recently joined us. Since we will continue for the foreseeable future to be a community both on campus and dispersed to over 30 countries and close to 50 states, I ask that we all make an extra effort to extend a warm Lawrence welcome to all our new members. I look forward to working with all of you in finding new ways to sustain our vibrant learning community during this pandemic. I began to think about the theme of belonging and home for this matriculation convocation last spring in response to the societal convulsion created by both the pandemic and the deepening recognition of systemic racism in our culture. At that moment, I had no idea how personal this topic would become for me. This summer has been a time for me to reassess my priorities and decide to prioritize family, specifically my mother and my in-laws, over a position I love. Serving as your president has been the central privilege and pleasure of my professional career. David and I want to thank all of you who have allowed us to join, to belong, and to call this university and Appleton our home. Lawrence will always be in our hearts, and we will always be proud to call Appleton our home, no matter where we reside. What a year. I expect many of you feel, as I do, the pain, the conflict, and the dislocation in our society. The new presidential election cycle has unleashed overwhelming forces to divide us. Our country's attempt to reckon with systemic racism brings both hope and conflicting views of an aspirational future. Environmental degradation continues to march on around the globe. And the pandemic has curtailed ways to process all of this stress, has upended family life, and has created severe economic burdens on many of us and the institutions we serve. This chaotic environment filled with conflict, inequity, anxiety, and anger has forced me to raise basic questions about where I feel safe and accepted. Where are my roots? Where do I belong? Where is home? Can I truly feel at home in a purple state in a time when political discourse has morphed into verbal hand-to-hand combat and the middle ground has become suspect? When we moved to Wisconsin 8 years ago, I saw the state's political tradition as a strength, a place to fully explore all sides. Now it feels like an invitation to a daily political war. Many theorists who have explored the concept of belonging find that one of its central aspects is the need to feel that your whole identity is recognized and affirmed. This recognition is seen as an invitation to create a deep connection. If this is true, how can belonging be created in a society in which racism and bias against minority identities continues to exist? The pandemic has also made it harder to return to places where we once felt at home. The virus threatens every travel plan and has led countries and regions of the world to limit visitation. How can those of us who have deep human connection in multiple locations sustain ties that are integral to our sense of belonging? These questions and many others consumed me this summer. As Anne Balfour Ulanov recognized in an address she entitled Root, Uprooted, and Rootedness at the C.G. Jung Institute in Chicago last year, our world has reinforced internal flux rather than integrating themes. Privileged to join a sustained dialogue group on race and racism at Lawrence and in the Fox Cities, I realized that these questions are on many of our minds. Countless researchers have studied the human desire for belonging. Some posit belonging as the opposite of isolation. It ensures that we do not feel alone. Others suggest that finding meaning in one's life is anchored in the sense of belonging. Research has found that the smallest social belonging interventions can yield lasting positive impacts, effect on individuals. Many believe that belonging is critical to creating successful learning environments. In The Need to Belong, Roy Baumeister and Mark Leary suggest that a need to belong is a fundamental human motivation. They explain that two criteria must be present to create a sense of belonging: frequent and pleasant interactions with a few other people, which take place in a stable context, and an enduring framework of effective concern for each other's welfare. In Search for Belonging, an analytical framework, Marco and Tonsich takes this idea one step further. He suggests that belonging is a personal, intimate feeling of being at home in a place. For Antonsich, home here stands for a symbolic space of familiarity, comfort, security, and emotional attachment. But where does one find such a place? Is home where we spend our childhood, where we find residence and safety as adults? Or, as Robert Frost said, is home just the place where, when you have to go there, they have to take you in? In a book entitled The Politics of Belonging, Nira Yuval Davis analyzes the sense of belonging from the perspective of identity, politics, and intersectionality. She understands that people can belong in many different ways and to many different objects of attachment. These can vary from a particular person to the whole of humanity, in a concrete or abstract way, by self or other identification, in a stable, contested, or transient way. For Yuval Davis, even in its most stable, primordial forms, however, belonging is always a dynamic process. Olenov also emphasizes this process. She describes belonging as the searching for an environment safe enough to become our own most selves. By our own most selves, she means an environment where we find, explore, and create ourselves. She believes we discover or uncover this root of belonging rather than create it. Archbishop Desmond Tutu calls this Ubuntu, the assertion of being human. Breen Brown, in her book, The Gifts of Imperfection, also acknowledges the common human need to belong. She emphasizes the complexity of achieving what we long for. Belonging, she writes, is the innate human desire to be part of something larger than us. Because this yearning is so primal, we often try to find it by fitting in and by seeking approval, which are not only hollow substitutes for belonging, but often barriers to it. Because true belonging only happens when we present our authentic, imperfect selves to the world. Our sense of belonging can never be greater than our level of self-acceptance. Natasha Trethewey captures beautifully in a poem, Theories of Time and Space, this challenge that faces us as we seek to belong. She writes, "You can get there from here, though there's no going home. Everywhere you go will be somewhere you've never been." It sounds so simple to create for oneself, right? Like many of you, I think my own sense of belonging springs partially from my upbringing. In the Jewish tradition, the biological family provides the core for belonging, and those of us who have family are obligated to create it for others. For example, on the central Jewish holiday, Passover, the Bible instructs us to gather in family units to feast and celebrate. Family is so central, there are special rules requesting every existing family unit to invite the stranger who is without familial connection. This has been translated into our current tradition of an elaborate ceremony over dinner called a Seder, which involves roles for each family member and encourages families to invite those without a home to join the celebration. Kwame Anthony Appiah takes the power of biological family one step further to establish belonging. In the preface to his book, In My Father's House, Africa in the Philosophy of Culture, He describes his sense of belonging as living in two extended families divided by several thousand miles, an allegedly inseparable cultural distance that never, so far as I can recall, puzzled or perplexed us much. As I grew older, I learned that not everybody had family in Africa and in Europe. Not everyone had a Lebanese uncle, American and French and Kenyan and Thai cousins. And now that my sisters have married a Norwegian and a Nigerian and a Ghanaian, now that I live in America, I'm used to seeing the world as a network of points of affinity. Now, that is what I call home. For many of us, the people we choose make a family and create belonging. In families we choose, lesbian, gays, kinship, Kath Weston explores this phenomenon. She points out that the sign on the stage at the 1987 Gay and Lesbian March on Washington read, "Love makes a family, nothing more, nothing less." Members of the LGBTQ community and many of the rest of us create family, roots, belonging through connections to spouses and friends. As Reginald Shepherd, an African-American poet, wrote in a book dedicated to his husband entitled, "You, Therefore," home is nowhere, therefore you, a kind of dwell and welcome, song after all, and free of any Eden we can name. Clearly, for some of us, confidence persists in the power to create the place where we truly belong. Antonsich suggests that other modes of belonging exist outside of family, both biological and created. Bell Hooks, in her book Belonging, A Culture of Place, offers a compelling meditation on how location itself can create this sense of rootedness. Hooks's view of her native Kentucky is not sentimentalized. She chronicles the racism and the culture of white supremacy of her childhood in complicated and painful ways. But still, her heart returns to the landscape and the people of her early years. At the end of a chapter entitled "Kentucky is My Fate," she writes, "During my time away, I would return to Kentucky and feel again a sense of belonging that I never felt elsewhere, experiencing unbroken ties to the land, to home folk, to our vernacular speech." Place, as well as people, becomes the sustainer of belonging. Many other traditions also connect belonging to a place or location. From the Native American perspective, for example, Paula Gunn Allen, a well-known poet from Laguna Pueblo, made this connection very clear. "We are the land. To the best of my understanding, that is the fundamental idea that permeates American Indian life." This view of belonging certainly makes sense here in the land of Nina, Menasha, and Winnebago, all names that originate in Native American language and tradition. But the idea exists as well in Victorian England. As George Eliot stated in Daniel Deronda, "A human life, I think, should be well rooted in some spot of native land, where it may get the love and tender kinship for the face of the earth." A strong link to an ancestral home is not central or at the core of everyone's sense of belonging. Pico Iyer, a British-born essayist of Indian descent who splits his life between Japan and California, put it this way in a TED Talk entitled, "What is Home?" "Home is really a work in progress. It's like a project, on which they're constantly adding upgrades and improvements and corrections. And for more and more of us, home has really less to do with a piece of soil than you could say with a piece of soul. Later in the talk, he mentions something that speaks directly to our mission here. Home, we know, is not just the place where you happen to be born. It's the place where you become yourself. Not all of us have had the privilege of finding a sense of belonging during our lifetime. Prejudice, racism, and bias have prevented many of us from finding spaces safe and supportive enough for us to develop a sense of belonging. Candace Pipes chronicles the lives of Black servicemen returning to the United States in an article called "The Impossibility of Home." She offers many examples of young men and women who enlist, thrive in the military, and fought for our country. But when they return, they encounter the same prejudice and racism that marked their lives before their military service. From a different perspective, Steve Streifler in Neither Here Nor There, Mexican Immigrant Workers and the Search for Home, provides insight into the lives of people who have become an essential workforce in the United States as farm laborers, meatpackers, and menial factory staff. As the title suggests, their work here may lead to higher income, but also to a persistent sense of dislocation and alienation. Tragically, these experiences are repeated in many situations. Others point to societal alienation and dislocation as forces working against our sense of belonging. In Home, Toni Morrison states, "What do we mean when we say home is a vital question because the destiny of the 21st century will be shaped by the possibility or the collapse of a shareable world." And Tonsich also believes that increasing cultural and ethnic diversification of contemporary societies could inhibit the formation of communities of belonging. Given what these sources tell us of the complexity, the challenge belonging presents now, here, can we possibly believe in our capacity to create home for ourselves and others? Popular culture, especially recent television programs, try to point a way forward. Multiple programs by Shonda Rhimes, like Grey's Anatomy, Station 19, and Scandal, use work settings to create diverse, inclusive families where straight and gay, Black, brown, and white characters all belong to each other and to a place. Ryan Murphy's many programs like Glee, 9/11, and Pose follow the same path by creating connectedness and belonging among diverse groups of people who support each other like traditional families. These become families in which we can all see ourselves. Of course, I recently wanted to be Travis Montgomery on Station 19. As a gay fireman with a Black firewoman best friend, he is beyond cool. Yes, his husband, a fellow fireman, died in the first season, but I digress. Although Rhimes stated once, "I am not changing the world, I am pretending to change the world on TV," the sense of belonging she creates illustrates for all of us the potential of redefining what belonging and home mean in this century. The story Rhimes, Murphy, and many others tell help us imagine the sense of home that Congressman John Lewis described in his Lawrence commencement speech in 2015. He said, So it doesn't matter if we are Black or white, Latino, Asian American, or Native American. It doesn't matter whether we are straight or gay. We are one people, one family. We are one house. We are brothers and sisters. His voice, his words, can still give us the courage to believe. It is now critical for us as a community to revisit these themes and to make sure that all members of the university feel that they belong here. This beloved learning community can and should become home for all of us. I look forward to hearing your ideas, reactions, and disagreements as we make Lawrence the home we all need it to be, one that spans geography, race, and all identities, one that helps us all to become ourselves. Whether you join us from afar or on campus, good luck in this new academic year. Thank you for recreating this learning community we call Lawrence, especially within the constraints of the pandemic. It is a pleasure to have you all back and engaged in the fall term. Thank you.
Lawrentians, President Burstein has invited us into a complex reflection on belonging and home. In the midst of a season when life-giving habits like hugging or breaking bread with others become unsafe, and neighbors or roommates turn into political enemies, we might hover on the edge of despair or isolate ourselves in self-defense. Regardless of our age or rank, our gender, race, or status, we resonate with Ulanov's description of the search for an environment safe enough to become our own most selves. Not perfect, but the imperfect, authentic selves for which the world is waiting. Together, we have the ability to love each imperfect self. Together, we can nurture the courage to create good trouble in our troubled world. The search can create the place when we live and act in the knowledge that each belongs here. I want to close us with David White's poem, "Everything is Waiting for You." Your great mistake is to act the drama as if you were alone, as if life were a progressive and cunning crime with no witness to the tiny, hidden transgressions. To feel abandoned is to deny the intimacy of your surroundings. Surely even you, at times, have felt the grand array, the swelling presence and the chorus crowding out your solo voice. You must note the way the soap dish enables you, or the window latch grants you freedom. Alertness is the hidden discipline of familiarity. The stairs are your mentor of things to come. The doors have always been there to frighten you and invite you. And the tiny speaker on the phone is your dream ladder to divinity. Put down the weight of your aloneness and ease into the conversation. The kettle is singing even as it pours you a drink. The cooking pots have left their arrogant aloofness and seen the good in you at last. All the birds and creatures of the world are unutterably themselves. Everything, everything, everything is waiting for you.